Welcome to Face to Face. This is a show about change and what's next. It's a show that asks questions and peels back the layers of our average everyday experience and goes beyond scratching the surface. We interview people doing incredible things who are making a difference around the globe. Join me as we listen in and get one step closer to understanding that big ideas shared create collaboration. Collaboration can inspire community, and communities create social change. I'm David Peck, and this is Face to Face. So my next interview is with Thomas Balmes, and we talk about his new film, Sing Me a Song, Happiness, Babies. Perhaps you've seen a few of his films before. What a wonderful time we had chatting about this, what I would call a beautiful and deeply unsettling film on so many levels, and yet ultimately quite hopeful. And this is a documentary that really, I think, uses, and I was going to say relies on, I don't think that's the right way to put it, but uses images, stark, beautiful, stunning images to really tell the story, and minimalistic almost. I hope that's okay, Thomas, to speak that way about the film. But we follow a young boy who's becoming a man, who falls, I guess you could say falls for, I was going to say falls in love with a woman a long way away from where he is. And this young monk who is discovering technology and the screen, I guess you could say, for the first time. And so Thomas and I chat about the existential angst that can create in all of us, as parents, as people, as community members, as family members. We talk about the shifting of paradigms and worldviews and what our relationships to screens really are, and what does it mean that we spend so much of our lives looking down at this small screen, or maybe this sort of mid-sized screen, as we communicate with others. And is that the question? Are we communicating, or are we actually speaking with people? Are we being so precise that we're losing, that sense of community? Where's the knowledge, as T.S. Eliot says, where's the knowledge we have lost in information? Where's the life we've lost in living? So we talk about that technology, and that we get into Silicon Valley a little bit. And I think the notion of responsibility and what that actually means about the folks who've spent their lives building this system that we all seem to have just kind of slid into. We talk about the purity of a first camera experience, and what does that even mean? And Thomas speaks about it and gets into some of the implications. And this is a deeply existential film. I highly recommend it. It's coming out in January 2021. Look for it. I hope you're going to be able to get to see it in a theater. You really need to do that. Also beautiful on a large screen, but definitely a theatrical piece for sure. And stay tuned for the interview with Thomas coming right up. And don't forget davidpecklive.com for more information about my writing and my speaking, and facetofacelive.ca, which by the way is all being redirected to a new website in the very near future. Very simple, I hope, and crisp and easy to navigate. And please, if you like what we're doing here and are listening, I would love it if you could leave a review for Face to Face on iTunes. Give us, if you're listening on YouTube, a like. Please follow us on YouTube. Sign up for the newsletter. We only send out 6 a year, just to keep you up to date on what we're up to. And check out the rest of our interviews. If you found us through iTunes or Spotify or one of the usual suspects, I think this interview is probably going to be around the 545th interview I've published in the last 7 or 8 years. So stay tuned for more. We've got so many more exciting interviews coming this year, and lots of little surprises along the way as well. But don't touch that dial. Coming right up, Thomas Balmes talking about his new, beautiful new film, Sing Me a Song. Well, welcome to Face to Face. We're joined by a very special guest here with us today. And once again, we are digitally face to face, but I think we're crossing a pretty large body of water to get to our first guest today. We have Thomas Balmes here with us today to talk about his new film, Sing Me a Song. Thomas, thank you for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
So many, first of all, congratulations on the film. I'd love for you to give our listeners a little bit of context about the film and about your interest in this marvelous, mysterious country of Bhutan, and maybe what drew you in. You're critically acclaimed, award-winning filmmaker. You've you've done some beautiful, beautiful films in the past, much like this one. I was a huge fan, by the way. So thank you. It was beautiful. And you know what? Very unsettling in so many ways, this film. So yeah, please give our listeners a little bit of context and let's go from there.
Well, I would say that for the last 25 years, I think I'm just doing the same thing on different subject. But I like to change paradigm and how we see the world through the way other societies and countries are being impacted by the Western society. So this could be spending some time in Kenya with some Maasai warriors who had been sent to Bosnia during the Bosnia War as blue helmets for the United Nations, when no one explained them why they were sent there. It could be speaking with some Indians during the mad cow disease when the UK decided to kill millions of cows, knowing that in India every single cow contains all the gods, and that it was potentially for them considered as an holocaust of the cows. Mm-hmm. So potentially I've been always doing repeating this kind of change in paradigm to try to for us to potentially question ourselves about the obviousness of the way we are doing things and doing wars and eating this and not eating that and watching this and not watching that. And among those subjects, I felt that our relationship with screens, digital and mobile phones, was something which was taking so much space worldwide. And I could see this growing in the last 15 years, which was 5 years when I started the project 10 years ago, that I was looking for a location in a place where there was no screens at all.
Right.
And I decided to follow someone who had never seen either a television or a computer or a mobile phone, and to see the impact of the arrival of these screens in his life and in his community. And this is how I ended up in Bhutan, and then from Bhutan to Laya, and then from Laya to Pyongki. That I've been following through 10 years and did two films about him.
It's a remarkable commitment. I remember talking to a videographer a few years ago, and he said, I just don't have that kind of commitment to tell to tell a story that could take potentially, in your case, 10 years, really, when you started following Pyongki at 8, I believe. Wasn't it 8 years old?
Exactly. You know, it's very funny because I do have 4 kids of my own, and I'm not known to be the most patient person in the world. So I think every individual is patient for some things and absolutely not patient for others. But I would say that for having a story happening and letting it happen by itself. Because I don't know to do anything else in terms of way to tell films, that I'm very patient with that. But believe me, there is many other subject on which I'm absolutely not patient at all.
Well, it really is fascinating what as individuals, human beings, what draws us in. What is it? What are the questions that drive us, in a sense?
Yeah.
And for Thomas, is it you mentioned perspective. Are you hoping that I, as the viewer, the Western viewer particularly, is going to step into this other culture and ask new questions about my own, I don't know, my own understanding, my own relationship to spirituality, to others, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah. This is I'm really considering all these films. This one is being shot in Bhutan, but I really don't consider it to be a film about Bhutan. I really consider it to be a totally universal story. And in Pyongki, I see my own kids, my own teenagers.
Of course.
And I could really, with very little differences, you could, I think, find very, very similar stories worldwide. And this is what I'm trying to do endlessly, is really to bring up these universal things to allow us to challenge and to reconsider our own behavior. It looks like it's working, And let's see how the American audiences will react to it. But in France, we had some kind of very interesting feedback, and this created some kind of real big discussions among communities in schools, and we are creating great debates after the film. And it's very first time among all the films I've done that I was really willing to have a kind of very concrete discussion coming out of the film in this way. I don't think this was so precise in the previous film I'd done. For this one, I feel the threat and the danger of the addiction of all this new generation to these mobile phones as something really, really potentially scary. And I'm very interested in hearing all the people who have created these tools, all this app from the Silicon Valley and all that, on how they are like, when they have left the company they used to work for, start to speak and do participate in another kind of documentary than the one I've been doing, but with the same kind of idea behind, I think, by raising some attention to the kind of addiction that it can create and the kind of space that it can take in someone's life. And it's specifically disturbing when the people are just starting to spend like 13 hours per day on their mobile phones, which is the average of a teenager in France today, which I think is very similar to a teenager in the US. And so I don't have anything myself against this technology and against these tools. It's just a question of what you do and how much time and how much space it takes to other things, you know, about reading, doing music, doing this and that.
Of course.
And I find it very interesting to hear all the people working in Silicon Valley sending all the kids in a Montessori school with no screen at all, forbidding entirely any screen at home, and being very radical, because I think they understand the potential threat of this technology.
It's interesting. I wonder about that. I've got two teenagers, and you know, my daughter will get mad at me for saying it, but she was up early this morning, 6:30 a.m., and the first thing she did was come downstairs, say hello to her father, and picked up her phone. It's just, it's ubiquitous. It's everywhere. I did the same thing. So I'm not making a critical judgment, as I don't think you do in the film at all. It's very, very observational. And by the way, I mean, talk about storytelling through stark images, Thomas. I mean, just some beautiful, beautiful images and really unsettling images. The lineup outside the internet cafe of all these young Buddhist monks. I mean, there's just some beautiful tracking shots, and the establishing shots too, just really set us up for that juxtaposition and that unsettling contrast, you know? And yet we're all in this together, it seems to me, right?
As absolutely. Kids, as a culture. Absolutely. And this is something, and I don't put myself even out of that. I just ended up having one phone, but only a few weeks ago I had two mobile phones because I needed to be working on this and that. And you can work everywhere. And when you're working for yourself, you don't have anyone telling you this is the end of the day. So you end up like, I think we are all exactly in the same thing. Mm. But I think it's interesting to challenge that obviousness and to create some kind of discussions, you know, and to potentially have some kind of time in the day where we can put our phone down and stop to speak again one with another and take some lunch together and with that.
That's,
you know,
right.
I was even fighting yesterday at home to have my 17-year-old daughter putting down her phone while we were having a lunch together, you know. At one stage, you know, if the discussion is not interesting enough, okay, let's see what's going on Instagram. Is there something more interesting than what is going on this dinner I'm having with my dad, you know?
Would you say, I've got so many questions, by the way. I feel like this could be a 2-hour interview easily. I'd love for you to teach a university course on this. This is, I mean, to really the observations and so on, the insights, I think. And really, here's a comment or a question about narrative filmmaking. You could have had an expert talking about the damage done by spending too much time on screens. And yet what you give us are images of young Buddhist monks playing guns and POV shooter games and lining up outside an inner cafe. Do you think those kinds of techniques and storytelling will stick with me, the viewer, and have more of an effect than, say, an expert psychiatrist, psychologist, mental health specialist talking about, you know, the implications?
You know, I'm absolutely not against when it's well done, these other kind of films. And I think they really deserve to exist. And you have Alex Gibney, who is a master in doing this kind of very good narration with expert and interviews and all that. It's not the it's not what I'm into, and I'm not that interested in doing this kind of project. The more it goes, the more I'm really into potentially, even if I could get rid of any dialogue and do a film only which could work visually, which was something I've done already with Babies, you know. So Babies didn't have a single piece of dialogue, and it was nevertheless released in almost 600 theaters in the US and worldwide.
It makes it universal.
Exactly. And this is something I'm really interested in doing, to work on cinema and to work visually and to work with the specificity of the media. You know, now we are doing a radio show. You could write a book. You have plenty of media. To me, the uniqueness of documentary is reality. And there is something I'm very keen on, is really playing with the specificity of this media, which is documentary. One kind of documentary, which is to me cinéma du réel, or like observational, or whatever you can call it. To me, I have so much pleasure to work with this reality, which you cannot write, you cannot predict how long it's going to take you. You don't know where it's going to bring you. As long as there are going to be people who are going to be crazy enough to give me money to keep on doing that, I'm going to try to keep on doing that. But by the way, this is not sure it's going to be continuing endlessly, because Participant has been financing in big ways this film, but there are very few companies who have this kind of trust on directors and on visions, and who allow them to spend, if you have 1 year more shoot needed, we're going to allow you to do it, you know. And there is a kind of uniformization of how documentaries are being made and produced, which is getting much closer to what you were describing before with Talking Heads, and it's much quicker to do and much cheaper. And
It follows a formal structure too, doesn't it? And it kind of resolves in a way that observational documentary filmmaking kind of sometimes, or at least sometimes, doesn't.
I think there are like so many things you can do, and they're like so great comedies with documentaries, or like drama. They're like, plenty of things, and it's been reducted to something very simple and very kind of poor compared to the potential of the genre, that I find a bit stupid to stay to that. And it's much more dictated by TV, which just pushed people to think that the documentary should be interviews and images in between the interviews to illustrate these interviews. And I would say 99% of documentaries are being made this way, and I'm fighting to allow something else to exist. And for example, I don't want to speak about Netflix, which this film was redone for the big screen. Unfortunately, with the COVID, there are like a few countries where it's going to go straight to VOD and all that. But it's been crafted and fabricated to go to movies. But on the same subject, there is a very interesting documentary that was full of interviews of these ex-people, specialists and all that, which Netflix has been broadcasting on the network. And I think the two films combined together are very interesting. And the film is called The Social Dilemma, you know? I would really recommend for the people to maybe go and see Sing Me a Song. And then after that, if they're interested in the subject in a more technical and more informational way, they can watch this other film. But I don't think there is contradiction, and it's not one or the other. It's like,
right, it's not an either or.
It's interesting and brings up different kind of reactions and different kind of vision, you know.
Hey, Thomas, you know, you're I don't know, maybe you are or you aren't a good French existentialist at heart, but I certainly some of my philosophical background and training was in French and German existentialism, and for me your film is deeply existential. It really is. It raises some profound, serious, substantive, important questions about what it means to be human, and what it means to be in a community. I don't know if you've read John Berger in The Ways of Seeing, but he says something to the effect of the purpose of publicity is to promote a marginal sense of dissatisfaction in the viewer. And I didn't see that, but I like that. Yeah. And I wonder, is that what's kind of happening in communities like this Bhutanese community where, you know, Bianchi at 8 years old says, I'm afraid of electricity coming into our community. We fast forward to the implications of this technology, and it just makes me wonder about the little things that we do every single day that are having an impact on who we are and how we relate and so on.
Yeah, well, absolutely. But I mean, there is in Bianchi this fascination and this fear in the very beginning, which right. I find incredible, you know, and yes. Again,
fascination and fear is perfect.
Absolutely. And I didn't plan to have any interviews in my film, but because of the kind of uniqueness of the way he was speaking to me at that time, it was the very first camera he had ever seen. And he had never seen himself on a screen, or he had never seen anyone, or he had never seen any screen, which makes his words and the way he's speaking almost like poetry, almost right. like something right. where he's not in representation, and where he's not saying this, thinking that I'm expecting this, or what the people are going to think if I say this or that. This right. is like right. Totally kind of a...
Right, no expectations.
Exactly. The pureness of that made me, I was so moved when he spoke to me like that. And something interesting, all these kind of words he's saying at the very beginning, it's something I didn't even was planning to do. This is scouting footage. I was just doing my casting and speaking to a few people, and I was never thinking of keeping that at all. And I didn't keep it in happiness. I just took it back because in Sing Me a Song, because I felt, wow, this is raw words, which are like really so, you know, he was speaking about planes and fire, and he wants to see planes, and the way he was fantasizing about all this technology potentially arriving in this village was, I find, super poetic, you know. It reminded me about these Kenyan warriors when I was interviewing them when I was doing Bosnia Hotel, and they were speaking to me about the snow. They were living in Kenya and they had never seen snow. And this was totally out of the subject, but I kept them allowed them to speak about snow for 10 minutes in the film because I felt this was like pure poetry, and I love to do that in my films, you know, not to be too efficient, but just to leave this kind of moment exist.
What I love about what you said is I actually have been to Kenya. I spent time in Eldoret many years ago, and I remember trying to describe ice to somebody in this really rural community. They had no refrigeration whatsoever in this small little village in Eldoret. And it is fascinating how we can step into those worlds through storytellers like yourselves. And I think it's so beautiful about documentary filmmaking. We've got to wrap it up in a couple of minutes here. And I wanted to talk a little bit about the relationship, and I don't want to give too much away for our viewers again. And you're going to have to, the film is opening soon, Sing Me a Song. Igu, if I'm pronouncing her name right, when they first met, the scene of him sort of ignoring her at the new information he's been told, and I think her line was something to the effect of, you looked a lot bigger on WeChat. Wow, I'm so glad you left that line in, because isn't that what, you know, and that's the marginal dissatisfaction again, right, from John Berger, that it's just a big letdown ultimately.
And by the way, this is the reason why he started crying. It's not because she already had a kid or whatever. It's just the meaning. She was so mean with him and so tough. And this kind of, she felt she was so disappointed to see him. And you are small. And she's saying to her daughter, tell him he's little. Tell him he's small,
tell
you know.
Little.
This was so tough that he started crying. And this was totally unexpected again. This is exactly why I'm keeping on doing what I'm doing, you know, inside of these moments, you have things which are happening, which
beautiful moments.
Like babies, you know, it's like things that you cannot really recreate, you know, it's things which are happening only once, and that it's going to be different if you go back again, but it's never going to be the same. And there is this uniqueness, and this is what I'm trying to capture on every single scene and every single frame. It's something that potentially is happening once, and that you have to be there. And you, this is why I think it's worth spending 10 years following someone, because at the end you have something which doesn't look like anything, you know.
It doesn't look like anything else.
It's a bit, it's and I like this singularity of doing weird projects. Like it was a fate, same thing with babies, you know, how you're going to spend 90 minutes with no dialogues and all that. And I like this kind of challenges and trying to also play with the genre. And for this one, I really wanted the film to look like a fiction, which made some kind of questions among the viewers. Is it a fiction? Is it a narration? Is it a documentary? And I find it also very interesting, connected to the subject itself of the project as a film, you know, what is real, what is fake, and who is this guy I'm going to meet on Tinder? Is it is he real, or is he going to be different from what I'm fantasizing is, you know?
Well, it's a beautiful film, and I'm glad you stuck with it and were committed. And I truly hope you go on to make these kinds of stories and show these kinds of stories. It allows us to step into something. It truly is a real gift. You know, it makes me wonder if Payanki and Igu, had they met first and then developed their relationship. And then developed their relationship on WhatsApp. What then would have happened? And it's a question that I hope audience members ask. And I'm looking forward to your next film, frankly. You know, what's part three of this story? So, yeah. And sadly, we've got to wrap up. But what a pleasure chatting with you today. I feel like we could go on for a couple of hours. We've barely scratched the surface. And isn't that...
Let's organize that another time.
A wonderful thing.
We can schedule.
That would be wonderful. Thomas Palmez today talking about his beautiful and unsettling and deeply moving new film, Sing Me a Song. Thomas, thanks so much for joining me on Face to Face today. I really do appreciate it.
My pleasure. Thanks so much.